Over the years, bikes have advanced.
A lot.
I love retro kit.
Yeah, and I love modern aero bikes. So much so that we've decided to combine our two passions and come to the Silverstone Sports Engineering Hub, a cycling-specific wind tunnel, to pit the latest, most high-tech, cutting-edge, modern aero bike tech against Jon's beautiful retro tech to see just how much faster an amazing bike like this is going to be over Jon's.
Well, if it's faster, mate.
It will be, but before we show you just how much faster mine is, then you know the drill. Subscribe if you haven't already, and also click the little bell icon.
Right, mate, let's go and get you dressed up.
What?
Oh yeah, I haven't told you about that. You're gonna love this.
The testing protocol is as follows. We have three setups: a retro bike with retro clothing, a retro bike with modern aero clothing, and a modern aero bike with modern aero clothing. With these setups, we will be measuring how aerodynamic they are at three different speeds: 25 kilometers an hour, a speed that most of us ride at, 35 kilometers an hour, a speed that most of us aspire to ride at, and 45 kilometers an hour, a speed generally reserved for pro riders and descents. We'll be measuring the power required to ride each of those setups at each of those speeds. In addition, we will also be testing the two bikes in isolation without riders, and we felt that that was a good place to start. The data from the wind tunnel is recorded as CDA values, which is the engineering term for the drag coefficient of whatever you're measuring. The lower the drag coefficient, the more aerodynamic an object is. The CDA value allows us to calculate a wattage value, which we will call aero watts for simplicity. And this is the data we are presenting. This is the power required to overcome aerodynamic drag at the different speeds.
Well, Ollie, it is nice to be behind a desk again, isn't it?
Yeah, it's nice, much warmer in here than that tunnel.
Yeah, you were getting pretty cold in there all day.
It's blowing a gale, isn't it?
Right, we should look at the numbers then, because, well, what looks aerodynamic might not necessarily be aero.
Yeah, so computed the results here, and first up, we'll do the results for just the bikes on their own with no riders on.
Yes.
Now we're going to present all the results in the same way. So first up, we're going to look at the CDA, which is the drag coefficient, and then we're going to present that as aero watts, which is the watts you would need to produce in order to overcome aerodynamic drag for a given speed. So we're going to present all three speeds we tested, 25, 35, 45. And these will appear on screen, so if you do want to pause it and have a look longer, you can.
Yeah.
So first up was your bike.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, the Eddie Merckx.
And we can see that the drag coefficient increases slightly as speed increases. That's fairly normal. And to overcome aerodynamic drag, your bike on its own, to go 25k an hour, needs to create 27.6 watts.
Yeah.
Not a huge amount, but it's just a bike on its own.
Yeah.
As soon as you then go up to 45k an hour, that becomes 146.7 watts because, drag is not linear.
No.
That's the answer to that. Now, so when we go on to the F12, that translates to aero watts of 21, 56, and 115 at respective speeds.
Yeah. So, considerably less.
Considerable saving, and a massive saving in particular, the faster you go.
Mm.
So, you're getting a bigger aero saving at those higher speeds.
Yeah. That's just the bike on its own.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's slightly counterintuitive, really, to what we think in our minds, isn't it? That skinny tubes are going to be faster, you know, a cylindrical shape and everything.
Yeah.
But we learned that anyway. Last year in the Retro versus Modern.
Yeah. The look video.
Yeah.
That I did with Sai.
Yeah.
If you open any aerodynamics textbook, pretty much the first page will be a picture of a cylinder and it will say, cylinders are bad news when it comes to aerodynamics.
Ollie's never one to to exaggerate on these things. Page one, that's it.
Yeah, but modern bikes of, you know, like the Pinarello F12 have got carefully tuned and honed aerodynamic shapes designed to minimize drag. A lot of the time with modern bikes, these shapes, it's not marketing, although marketing is used to sell it, it is physics that is the basis behind this. And this is why we don't see cylindrical shaped trains or spaceships.
Quantum physics?
Quantum physics is in everything, but this isn't specifically quantum physics.
Good.
So next up, we tested with riders on both those bikes, me. But the reason why we tested without a rider was because we could do, and it's the rider can be a source of error because it's hard to maintain a constant position.
Yeah, now the good thing actually about the Silverstone Sports Engineering Hub tunnel is that you had that outline, didn't you? So you could look down and you could actually see
the projection.
Exactly where you were meant to be sitting, you know, during the initial runs and everything. And I had great pleasure, actually, Ollie, in watching you sit there and try and hold that position for hours on end.
Ollie, I never thought I'd see the day I'd let you ride my pride and joy. And to be honest, you actually look quite good on it, which is annoying me, I must say, a little bit. But how does it feel, first of all? Because it's a bike probably that you've... Have you ever ridden anything as old as this?
I have, but... I mean, it feels beautifully smooth. You've taken good care of it.
I have.
But it's miles different from my Pinarello. Yeah. The handlebars, for one. I mean, they're just all over the place.
I thought you'd like them.
Wider as well, but it's modern bikes have increasingly narrow bars. Mm. It's a bit more aero. Something else I can see when I look at the line guide we've created is that to adopt the same relaxed position on the hoods, I mean, I can't really do that.
No.
It feels like it's much more designed to be in the drops as a standard all-day position.
Yeah.
And I can see that's already much lower than my standard all-day position on the modern bike.
It's going to be interesting, I think, how the results come out on this because, you know, you're on the drops, so you're a lot lower, but it's just how the overall package is going to work.
Yes.
Because, well, we've got 32-hole, you know, standard box section aluminium wheels.
So what I'm going to do is to try and keep it consistent because we want to see what the bike's difference is.
Okay.
I'm actually going to try and replicate the position using the line guide, which means I will be coming up a bit higher onto the hoods.
Yeah.
But it will make it more consistent to see what the difference between the actual bikes is rather than me.
Yeah.
Which is what we want to find out.
I think we can do that a little bit later on, though. Maybe we can throw something else into the mix. I think, you know, just to see. I've got my dressing up box today, so you're all going to be in for a treat, I think.
Right, let's run the tunnel then.
Okay, mate. Right, just go easy on her, please.
Yeah.
Please.
I'll take good care of her.
Please do.
So we've got the retro bike, but then we did it with modern clothing to begin with. And you can see the CDA values there. And this translates to aero watts of 87 watts to overcome 25 kilometers an hour. And that's a bike and the rider. To go 35, 212 watts was coming out at.
Yeah.
And 435 would be the number of watts you do for 45k an hour.
Yeah.
This is, I should stress as well, just aero watts. So there would be about roughly 10% additional watts required to overcome friction within the drivetrain and the tyres. When we compare that to the modern bike with modern clothing.
Yeah, here we go.
You can see there's a huge difference. So you can see there that instantly the drag coefficients are much, much lower with the modern clothing. And the wattage saving there, you're looking at 79 watts for 125, 191, and then just 410. 410 for 45k an hour versus the
435?
Yeah,
435.
Yeah, 25 watts.
Yeah.
Significant.
Yeah.
And something to point out here is that while you can see that there is a trend, that there is a greater wattage saving at those higher speeds, it actually works out roughly the same at the lower speeds in terms of a saving, because the person riding at the lower speed is out on the course longer. So although the saving is less, the overall time saved is roughly the same because they're on the course longer.
Yeah, that's something which often is not sort of spoke about that much, is it? At slower speeds, which is hence why we wanted to do this video at realistic speeds, because so many press releases we get, for example, at 55 or 60k an hour, but no one is riding at that speed.
Yeah.
Really,
obviously.
But yeah, I mean, you know, there are riders out there doing sportives that are out there for 5-6 hours riding at 25k an hour.
Yeah.
So that's why this data, I think, is so valuable to them.
Yes, even 6 watts at that speed can be hugely significant if you are chasing a time. You might not be chasing a time, in which case you're probably not even bothered about watching this video. But if you know, if you are, then that is significant over a massive course that is 5-6 hours long.
Yeah.
So then we tested the retro bike with retro clothing.
Yeah, this was probably my favourite part, actually.
Yeah.
Seeing you dressed up like that.
Thanks, man.
You wouldn't wear those old shorts, though. I was a bit annoyed about that.
You haven't washed them.
Right, Ollie, I see you found my dressing up box. You're looking all right.
Thanks, man.
Have you seen yourself in the mirror?
No, I haven't. I don't think I want to.
Yeah, anyway, I see you haven't quite gone, you know, the whole hog, basically, because you didn't use those nasty old bib shorts that I left laying around, so you've kept on your current ones, so I can forgive you for that, I suppose, and also you've kept the arm warmers on, because you have been in here quite some time now, a little bit cold, but you've put a couple of jerseys on.
Retro jerseys.
Yeah, you've also, but...
Retro
hat. Yeah, back then, mate, they used to have them undone. They used to have them catching the wind a little bit. So there we go.
Okay.
So we've got to be authentic. And you've got the trusty helmet on too.
Yeah.
They didn't really do any good, did they?
These aren't period correct eyewear.
No.
I have to stress, this is for health and safety. I don't want to get particles of dust and stuff from the wind tunnel in my eyes.
Yeah, but how do you feel?
Feel like I want to get changed. So let's run the test.
Okay, right. Here we go. 25, 35, 45k an hour.
And we're going to maintain the same body position using the template.
Yeah. It's not as easy on this old bike, though, is it?
No, but I can do it.
Yeah.
Do it.
I've got my faith in you.
Cool. Let's do it.
Go on, mate. Go for it. Come on, retro.
This is the real interesting one for me.
Yeah.
When you combine the retro bike with the retro clothing, you see a huge difference.
Yeah.
And what this clearly shows is that above and beyond, the biggest difference is not the bike, it's the clothing you wear and probably the position you're in, but that's another story.
Yeah.
But the clothing makes a ridiculous difference. So 488 watts to go 45k an hour versus with the retro bike with modern clothing,
was it 435? Yeah.
I mean,
50 watts.
I say, I could train for 100 years and never get that kind of improvement.
No. But through a different bit of kit.
Yeah.
And easier as well than training.
People will happily drop thousands of pounds on a brand new bike and ignore the clothing. But for considerably less expenditure, you can buy faster clothing, a faster helmet, and save much more in terms of make go much quicker. You know, we look at the modern, the modest speed. So if 25k an hour is 93 watts for retro bike and retro clothing. And if we then compare that, so that's not, you know, then you're looking at
6 watts.
About 3 watts on the for the clothing at lower speed, but considerably more on the faster bike.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's going to make more when you start to go up to the faster speeds. The less aerodynamic clothing is clearly making a huge difference.
It's really interesting to see this.
Yeah.
And you think, you know, when you're riding, you get a little bit hot, you undo your jersey a little bit, the difference that will suddenly start to make.
Yeah, but
I mean, we could have spent literally days in there going through all of these different experiments, and I wish we had the time, because to be able to relay that back to people, I find quite rewarding.
Yeah.
Like, you know, where you can make those marginal gains.
And But the other thing is people who say, oh, well, I never ride at 45K an hour. Well, I'm sure you do.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean you have to be riding all the time. Mm. Because what you can see there is the huge disparity in drag between 45K an hour with the retro clothing and the modern clothing means that if there's a part in your event or sportive where you're trying to drop your mates and you go down a hill where you hit 50, 60K an hour, if one of you's wearing fast clothing and one's wearing not fast clothing, that's the moment where you will have a huge advantage. If you want to break away from them at that point or attack them or get a gap, that's where you'll get the gap. And in cycling, it's often about who can get the gap.
Yeah,
you know,
and you see that actually in pro racing as well. You know, years ago, top of climbs, riders nearly all the time, regardless of the weather, would put a cape on.
Yeah.
These days they don't, because a cape is flapping around.
Yeah.
It means they can't keep up with their competitors if they're not wearing a cape.
Or they have to expend a lot more energy.
Yeah. No one wants to do that on a descent.
No.
And try and recover. But this has been really interesting, and there is loads of different tools out there as well for you to play around with, isn't there? If you want to, you know, imagine if you were to save a few watts here, and you could then try and get a PB on your local climb.
Or your event. If you've got an event coming up and you want to see what difference maybe 10 watts would make, then yeah, there's loads of brilliant online calculators like Best Bike Split, My Windsock.
Yeah, Bike Calculator.
Yeah, those sorts of things that are worth a play around with. And you can see it gets pretty significant.
Yeah, it starts to tell you how much time you save as well. And that's when you start to get a little bit excited.
Yeah. Right, well, we hope you've enjoyed this video and found it informative and useful. It's been pretty fascinating testing an old bike versus a modern bike.
It was great to see it, actually, in that kit. You were...
Thanks, man.
You played the part really well. Right, remember as ever as well to like and share this video with your friends too. And don't forget to subscribe to the GCN Tech channel.
And if you'd like to watch that retro versus modern look bike video, you can click down here.
Yeah, for another retro versus modern clip, just down here.